Basic treatment of sewage comprises three different parameters. One is physical treatment, chemical treatment, biological treatment. These are traditional treatment methods that is being used for any type of wastewater that is required to be treated. So this is the basic flow process of the STP plant, which is very common among all industries, which starts with screening, then moves to grit removal, primary settling, aeration or activated sludge treatment, then secondary settling, disinfection, and filtration. So this is a typical flowchart. I'd like to brief about this flowchart. So when a raw sewage enters into the treatment plant, we first usually have a bar screen or some other screen chamber. This screen chamber is especially used to remove the debris or bigger size particles such as stones, paper, or some other plastic materials. So this is the first step. Screen chamber is the first step of treatment. And then when the sewage treatment plant receives sewage from more than one part of the industry or one part of the household, then it is collected into a separate tank called collection tank. Here, since sewage from various parts are put together in one collection tank, it is equalized there. So all the parts of sewage, one might be from kitchen, one might be from toilet, so everything, or one might be from hostel, one might be from academic campus. So everything is put into one single tank and it is equalized. That is, all the sewage are mixed together and that tank is called as a collection tank or equalization tank. Then comes the primary settling tank. So preliminary settling is taking place here. The settling is taking place at the bottom here. So small particles are settled here. After the primary settling tank, it is then taken to the aeration tank. Aeration tank, the aeration may be given as open aerator or submerged aerator, anything can be given. So through air bubbles that is being produced artificially, here the sewage gets decomposed. Then it is moved to the secondary settling tank. Here maybe some of the particles might not get settled because of its size or because of the discrete thing, personality of the particle. When the aeration is being given, these particles may join together and form a flock, and then so bigger size particles are also settled here in the secondary settling tank. So after the settlement, the wastewater is being, the debris or the settled particles are collected together and it is called as activated sludge. So from all these three components, it is taken to the sludge drying place. Next comes the secondary treatment plant or secondary settling tank comes the storage contact tank. This is the disinfection tank. This is called as a disinfection tank. Most of the cases, chlorination dosing is being done. So chlorine is the main parameter that is being used for disinfection. So after disinfection, it is taken to a filter media. The filter media might have a single media or a dual media, or two different filters can also be placed in a separate treatment tank. This particular media, it has a dual media. The medias may be the gravel, sand particles, or activated carbon. So any type of media can be used for filtration. It depends on the parameters or characteristics of the wastewater that is being treated. So after this filtration, then the wastewater is taken out for reuse. That is, the effluent is being taken out for reuse. So as I said here, waste activated sludge is taken out and it is then sent to the sludge drying beds. Here, dewatering is being done since the wastewater will contain liquid in it. After dewatering, the dry sludge is let out for disposal. It can be taken out to the sludge drying beds directly, or it can be taken out for disposal in any landfill, or sometimes the wastewater is also used as a manure if it doesn't contain any harm chemicals in it. So this is a typical sewage treatment plant flowchart that is being commonly used in most of the industries or even in households. If there is any apartment or community place, there also we are using the similar type of treatment. So I'd like to introduce some of the new technologies. Most of you might know about this technology. Anyway, I'll give a brief introduction about the three technologies that is being used widely now. The first one is the sequencing batch reactor. Sequencing batch reactor is nothing but two or three treatment particles or treatment components are being taken together in a single unit, and two or three cycles is being carried out in each and every unit, and then it is let out for reuse. So here, It is a batch process in which primary aeration, primary settling, aeration, secondary settling. All these three components, earlier we saw, we have three different components. Primary settling is separate, aeration is separate, secondary settling is separate. So here all these things are put together in a series and it is called as a separate batch. Similarly, multiple batches can also be placed. It depends on the characteristics of the wastewater. So it comes as a cyclic process from starts with primary settling, then it goes to aeration, then secondary settling. Then if required, it is again sent to the second cycle. Then in second cycle also the same process is being carried out and the sludges are taken out, settled particles are taken out for disposal and the remaining water is taken out for reuse. So here multiple basins are used by, when one basin is one part of the cycle such as aeration, another tank will have settling or discharging, or all these tanks will be put together in a single tank. So anyway, this three treatment process put together, it is called as a batch reactor. Sequence batch reactor is nothing but one after another in a sequence, it is happening inside a batch, that is inside a separate unit. Here high efficiency fine bubble non-clog membrane is being used for aeration. Here aeration is the only process of treatment in sequence batch reactor. Be able to understand if I show this picture to you. So these are the basic treatment, as I already said, raw sewage, inlet chamber, screening, rich removal, everything is similar to the normal conventional treatment plant. Then comes the batch. Here SBR1 is a separate batch, SBR2 is a separate batch. In both these batches, aeration is being carried out. See here, you can see a blower. And this blower, from this blower, air is being blown through the sprinklers available. It is submerged, diffuses. So through this air is being blown and hence oxygen is supplied into this tank. And here the sludges is being taken out as return sludge. Here sludge removal is taking place. That is, decanter is nothing but the removal of the settled particles. That is called as decanting. So here we are placing a decanter also. So similarly, we have another SBR2. So two different parameters are used. I mean, two different batches or two different basins are being used here. This is called as a sequence batch reactor. Here, as usual, the return sludge is also used as a input for next cycle. And the surplus sludge is being taken out through the sludge pump, or it is being taken out to the centrifuge for sludge dewatering, and then it is taken out as a manure or for disposal. Similarly, here after this SBR1 treatment and SBR2 treatment, you can also have SBR3, SBR4 depending upon the characteristics of the wastewater. And then from all these treatment things, we can take it to the chlorine contact tank if required. And then to filtration also, if you want, you can fix the filtration unit here, or you can take directly the disposal. The difference between normal STP plant and sequence batch reactor is nothing but all these things are put together. Primary settling, aeration, secondary settling, all these things are put together. So we don't need any separate maintenance or separate component for it. It seems to be a compact thing. So the advantages is that it can remove, that is SBR can remove nitrogen and phosphorus along with the BOD. And the absence of order is there, because since we are putting all these things together in a one thing, order is not present here. Corrosive gases is also absent here. So improved aesthetics, since all are put together, combined as batch. It doesn't require any separate secondary clarifiers, and the major return sludge is taken out as pumping through the pumping sludge pumping unit, and less manpower is required because of the automatic control of each and every unit here. So disadvantages: sludge management provision is not given here, since we are decanting and we can take it out as a separate sludge drying process, a sludge drying bed. Inside the batch, we don't have any sludge management process. And no provision of primary treatment. This is a major disadvantage, is that we are not treating very much primarily. We are directly taking into the batch. Since preliminary settling is taking place inside the batch, the pollution load will vary, will be of very increased level. So the batch reactor might malfunction or dysfunction. So we need frequent maintenance there in this SBR 1 and 2, etc. And higher energy input is required because of the automation here. And though less manpower is required, that manpower should be semi-skilled, because both automated and manual things are happening here in this batch reactor. These are the disadvantages of sequence batch reactor. Next one is a moving wet bioreactor, that is called as MBBR. Similar to the sequence batch reactor, here we have the bed that is moving. So usually our treatment plants will contain a bed or treatment material or filter material fixed in some place, fixed in any filter or something. Here in MABR, we have a moving unit. The plus, that is, the benefit of this moving bioreactor is nothing but, since if it is a fixed reactor, we'll be having the top surface or the side surfaces for the microbes to grow. But since it is a moving one, we have the entire surface of this biofilm for the microbes to grow. That is, it is a ball size bioreactor is being used. That is, the bed will be similar to a ball. So if a ball is allowed to move around the reactor, the microbes can attach anywhere around the circumference of the ball. So if it is a fixed, only the top layer can be used by the microbes to grow. So since it is moving everywhere, the microbes can attach and microbes can grow, and then it maximizes the growth of the microbes, and then it decomposes all the unwanted materials. So here is also aeration is required. Diffused aeration is very much needed. And MABR is a highly effective biological water treatment process, which is based on combination of biofilm media and conventional activated sludge process. Both are being used here. And a special thing is that water can be treated in both anaerobic and aerobic environment. So here in SBR, aerobic process is the only process. In MABR, both an anaerobic and aerobic treatments can be done. So here, thousands of bioethylene biofilm carriers are used here. This picture, you can see small dot like this, and here you can see these are the biofilm balls. This MABR is a combination of anaerobic and aerobic process. Here we are feeding the inlet, and here we have the balls. So this is purely anaerobic, only the clarifier is here. So we don't have any aeration provision here. And then it can be sent to aerobic process. Here we have diffused aeration here at the bottom. We also have the biofilm here. Here also the microbe attachment will be good. And then the effluent is being treated. So this thing comprises of both anaerobic treatment and aerobic treatment in the same lab. Okay, the next one is only the aerobic treatment. So before coming to the aerobic treatment, we can pre-treat using some settling tank or something. And then we can take to MABR reactor 1. Here air blowers are produced, air blowers are used to produce oxygen. And here after MABR 1, reactor 1, it can be sent again to MABR reactor 2. So more nutrients can be converted. And then it is taken up for sedimentation, and then finally it can be treated. I mean, treated effluent can be used. So this is the difference between aerobic with anaerobic and only aerobic. These two are the two different types of MABR reactors. So the advantage is it requires a smaller storage place, since this is a very compact unit when compared to the oil treatment plants, and it is very easy to operate and maintain, and the structure can be easily covered for indoor air quality also. So it can be used indoor also, since it is very compact. And when anaerobic is used, we can directly cover the structure. So the third one is the fixed bed biofilm activated sludge process. So we saw moving bed, here we have fixed bed. Here the one important thing is that the fixed bed will be a plant. So a plant that can absorb or that can act as a biofilm carrier is used here in this FBAS process. So activated sludge attached growth process. It is an activated sludge attached growth process where the plant roots provide the area for the biofilm to develop and grow. So the aeration system is divided into series of biological reactors where fixed biofilm is maintained in every stage. Similar to SBR, here also the biofilm is fixed. Biodegradation of influent contaminants takes place mainly with the help of fixed biological cultures where plant roots are used as biofilm carriers. So additional textile media is used in the reactors as additional biofilm carriers. Apart from this biofilm carriers, textile media can also be used to cover the biofilm carriers if required. That is additional one. So the reactors are covered by a shading structure or a greenhouse. This is because for the protection of plants. Since plant is being used, it should also have shade. It should not be brought to direct sunlight, so greenhouse effect is required. And as the influent travels through the cascade, the available nutrient quantity is consumed. So whenever the nutrient is left inside and when it passes through the roots of the plant, the nutrient is consumed, and as a result, the composition of the ecosystem fixed in the biofilm changes from reactor to reactor. So any type of selected tested plants can be used here, and any textile media can be used to cover the plant. And so this fixed, I mean the composition of the ecosystem varies between the reactor to reactor depending upon the adaptation of this microbes to decrease the nutrient concentration. So in each cascade stage, specially adapted ecosystem will form, thus maximizing the decomposition of contaminants. So this is an example of fixed bed activated sludge process, and this is the plant that is being used and the root of the plant. Here this root of the plant can be covered with the textile media, as said here, can be covered. So double protection is being given here. So here if the inlet is given here, we have activated sludge in suspension. We are giving this activated sludge in suspension to decompose the nutrients, I mean decompose the chemicals and to form as a nutrition. Here we have fine bubble aeration also here. Then this root zone is being protected with the textile media. Plants on the supporting mesh. So here the mesh. So we are placing the plant here. So we are using activated sludge as a media, plant as a media along with the textile thing, and aeration is also being given. This is about the FPS. When the water is passed through this, influent is passed through this media, it gets absorbed and it converts the sludge into nutrients with the help of the oxygen that is being given here at the bottom, and then the effluent can be taken out as treated effluent. So this is about fixed bed activation sludge process. So the advantage of this process is that it requires much lesser land area than conventional activated sludge. This process is odorless, and hence with plants can be easily built in urban area. So this is not a conventional STP. Mostly we'll be using only plants. Plant is being used. It can be used, and it can be used in a locality where the human population is more, since it doesn't have any negative impact to the adjoining areas. So it can be well adopted for nutrition removal such as phosphorus and nitrogen, which is of major cause now. In colder climates, since the temperature is very abnormal, we can protect it using greenhouse, as said earlier. And because of the higher automation, the technology is not attractive for smaller size. These are some of the disadvantages. So the technology requires more qualified operators than other technologies, and this process is now yet to be validated in STPs. Now it is being used in abroad countries, but not yet in India. So the next and last treatment method is eco bioblocks. Most of us will be using this eco bioblock. Some of you might be heard about this eco bioblock. This is a very recent thing that is being popular. It is already there, but it is becoming popularized only in recent days, because nowadays we are using this eco bioblocks even in aquarium. So this bioblock is nothing but a concrete block with sealed effective bacteria. So effective bacteria will be sealed in a concrete block, which clarifies and improves the water quality. So EBB is a bioremediation product that contains effective bacteria in a dormant condition until immersed in water. So only when we immerse this block in water, this bacteria will become active. So if we are keeping the block as such, the bacteria will be in dormant condition only, and it can be kept for years together in this dormant condition itself, and it can be used when required. So when it is immersed in water, this bacteria begins to multiply and it starts cleaning the water by consuming the organic matter in the water. So this effective bacteria multiplies only above the temperature of 10 degrees Celsius. So it means that it remains dormant. It is dormant in the sense inactive. The bacteria becomes inactive below the 10 degrees Celsius temperature. So aerobic bacteria, and hence oxygen is very much required. This eco bioblock can be used only when oxygen supply is there. If fishes are swimming, oxygen is sufficient. So if no fishes are there in the treatment unit that you are providing, we need to supply oxygen or support with aeration units or submerged aerators in that particular. If you are growing fishes similar to aquarium. The no need of separate oxygen, since the oxygen will be sufficient in those type of units. So UV light cannot be used because it will destroy the bacteria. So mostly it cannot be exposed to the sun. So no change in effectiveness of the blocks if it is damaged. Or suppose if you are having a rectangular block and if a corner of the block is being broken when we are transmitting the block, it won't affect the effectiveness of the bacteria that is available as a dormant thing in the. So these are some of the advantages also. This is a picture of the Ecobio block. So this is a, this can be a concrete thing. Above these things we are forming a bacteria coat, and this, if when one while immersed in a water, it becomes active and it starts consuming the nitrogen, phosphorus and other materials that are available, that are given as a feed for this bacteria. So advantages: it will be more effective in places with oxygen, and Ecobio block will continue to be effective unless there is a severe change in water conditions and the bacteria not active. Suppose a heavy load of chemicals is being supplied all of a sudden, then the bacteria might have a change and might become ineffective. That is, it might, it depends on the characteristics, and a sudden change or a discrete change that is happening inside this unit where we are placing this Ecobio. The main disadvantage is that if you are using chemical disinfectants or sterilizers or some other unwanted things in the place where we are placing the block, then might disrupt the clarifying mechanism. So it might make the bacteria inactive. So this is a major disadvantage of this. So this is a short presentation about the recent technologies. And I think this will be the shortest presentation you ever see. Because I used 4 different technologies here. I think that in-depth knowledge of these technologies, most of you might be having the awareness, and some of you might need awareness. So I thought of telling all these things. We can start implementing in local plants or local domestic households. All these things can be tried over here, can be given as a student project for students. We are trying out here in our institutions now. It is really interesting for the students. And they are much more interested than learning about the conventional technologies. So I think this presentation would have been an informative one for you all. And I like to conclude my session. We never know the worth of water until the well is dry. So save water, save life. Save life. Thank you. Thank you for this opportunity, and thank you all the participants for your patience listening.